1-1.
Here are some of the boys I'm looking for. The Lee Henderson told me earlier they were down here in the audience. The Bee Gees, Barry A., the leader of the group, come here. Barry Gibb and your young brothers. Now, come on, who are you? Which is which? Your twins, eh?
I'm Robin.
Robin?
Morris.
And Morris. Now, you all sing together, eh?
What I mean is, when I say that it's us three against the world, I go back to all of the times in our past where we've been told we couldn't succeed. And when we first emigrated to Australia, we were a singing group who wrote songs, and in Australia we were told by a lot of people in the business that, you know, who wants kid act? And then suddenly young child acts started to sell records. I think when the Osmonds were kids, they started to have hit records, and the Ed Jacksons started to have hit records when they were little kids. It wasn't such a ridiculous idea after all. And when we first left Australia to try and make it internationally, we were told by the media then, you can't make it internationally, you just can't work for you. You know, stay in Australia and make good money. You know, work the clubs and work, and be big in Australia, and if you can be. But don't, you're not going to succeed. It's funny how there are always people to tell you you can't do it. And when we were in England, we arrived in England, we were told we couldn't, no one would sign us up. They told us it was impossible. They told us groups were out. We were told by a leading agent that groups were out in 1967.
I started a joke, which started the whole world crying.
And then in 1972, 73, we were told by the industry that we were finished. We'd had our hits in the 60s, and we'd had Massachusetts and all that, Gotta Get a Message to You and all those songs. And mid-70s, we were finished. I mean, that was the general attitude of the media, of the business. The groups were out. What I'm trying to say is that overall, all the way, we've been reminded over and over again that we can't succeed.
How deep is your love? Is your love?
Feels like it's always been an uphill battle, but somehow we've always managed to sort of just creep through that final hole with the light at the end.
The whole creative process has to be a teamwork. Yeah, a team job in the studio as well as the writing.
And songs to us are like babies. I mean, you give them birth and then you mold them and shape them and then make them, the finished record is a child grown up. And that's how we feel about our songs.
There's going to be a lot of arguments. You always have people sort of thinking that their idea is the best one, we're going to see it through.
It is a three-step thing. You start doing it, you start writing it, then you start laying down the music, and then you start singing it, in the end, producing it.
We have a system where we like something in our minds and want to see it through. We will see it through, and so if it works, and if it doesn't work, we won't do it. And I think that's a sort of pretty democratic way of doing things, you know, in the studio.
I like that one. I'm not happy with that. I think we can do it again.
She likes to know so many sizes, and I'd be the one to know.
Way back.
When am I gonna go to your dimension?
All kinds of different harmonies that we use, and Morris or Robin can take any harmony. In fact, we all take different harmonies. If Robin's singing lead, I'll take a harmony, Morris will take one, and it just revolves. It could be any harmonies at all. It's impossible. It's not a matter of saying, well, Robin takes third and Morris takes the fifth. In all cases, that's simply not true. We experiment in every case.
She likes to
We once again experiment a lot with our vocal sound, and I don't think anybody gets the sounds we get, because we work hard on it, and it's our sound, and it's, that's one thing you can't take away from us. You know, that's one thing we love to do, and people like to hear.
We were looking for something exciting at the end of Nights on Broadway, something like a scream of some sort, or and he said, you know, does anyone scream? And I know we had done falsettos of some kind on an earlier album, which weren't very good. And I said, well, okay, well, I didn't think I could do it. And he said, well, go out and just see if you can scream something in tune that's actually a scream but actually has a note to it, you know. And I went out to the microphone and did, I think it was...
Blaming It All!
The only other person I'd ever heard scream in tune was Paul McCartney on the end of Hey Jude. But this is the first time I heard Barry scream, and he was dead in pitch, and the scream was in tune. And it's like, how do you get an in-tune scream? You know, it was just brilliant.
Throat could do that, you know, and the more I did it, the better it got, and the stronger it got. It was nice to do ballads with falsetto. It was nice to do all those things, and we'd always been fans of the Beach Boys and the Four Seasons, and I'd always loved Frankie Valli's voice. Why did I never try to copy Frankie Valli? Because it was like the same type of thing, and I didn't know I could do it. And I'd heard, I'd loved all those records in the past, and never knew. An older sister, 2 years older, and she was the sort of Everly Brothers fan, and she would bring home all the rock and roll records, and we'd go, oh, listen to this, you know. Oh, sing
VH1 to 1.
Oh, my old man's a dustman, he wears a dustman's hat, he wears called blimey trousers, and he lives in a...
Well, I was 9 when I first started playing guitar, and Morris and Robin were 6 or 7.
Dad was always at the back going like this, you know, smile, you know, and all that sort of stuff. Yeah, he taught us professionalism.
He was very instrumental when we were children in, you know, teaching us the tools of the trade. And that's not to say that everything we do was taught by our father. He knows that. He just added those little things that he felt were important, like being, you know, like when you're bringing up children, you know, be polite to other people. Don't let your ego take over if you have success. Just things that a parent would say, you know. And I'll always thank him for that. He was fantastic.
Fashion on my head.
We knew we couldn't go too far in Australia. You can always go, in those days there was no satellite, nothing like that. So, you know, you only could go as far as you could go. And we left because we wanted to go international and try and do more internationally. It was either America or England. So we decided to go back home to England. And within 5 months we were in the studio recording and hanging out with the Beatles and all these people that we'd seen from such a far distance.
They were great, great role models for us to aspire to, because before the Beatles, of course, we were very young for the Beatles, so we don't know too much about that, but it was certainly the Beatles being a group and us being a group, it's, you know, one of the few things we could actually relate to as being doing the same things that we were doing, you know, harmonizing and composing.
Something's telling me I must go home.
And the lights all went down in Massachusetts.
And and Massachusetts is one place I have seen.
Morris and Robin, I know, don't, they're not comfortable with the oldest brother role. They don't like me being the eldest brother, in a sense. They don't like me trying to dominate. And the trouble is, when you are the eldest brother, you do it by nature. And you try to dominate just by nature because you're the eldest brother. You try to fill the role, you know, which is a mistake. And I've come to learn. You learn from each other. I don't try to dominate Morris and Robin. I listen to their opinions the same as they listen to mine. Everything's on an equal footing, an equal basis. And that is part of the way to survive too, you know. If one person tries to run the whole thing, it just doesn't work.
Three of us have three different things that make the chemistry work. I mean, when we write separately, it's okay, but when the three of us write together, it seems to have more impact. It seems to be more of a popular song. And I don't know what the chemistry is, it sort of clicks. I don't know, it happens between brothers.
Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking to Jones. I keep straining my ears to hear a sound. Maybe someone is digging underground. Or have they given up and all gone home to bed, thinking those who once existed must be dead? Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
It's impossible to describe the writing mode, the dream state, whatever it is that makes you create songs or write books. I go into the dream state. It's as simple as that, and I don't know how to explain that. It's just that all these things that. Maybe it's the child. You become the child. And it becomes that no matter what you write down, it's okay. And you can fail. That's all right too. You've got to be allowed to fail. And you write down anything that comes into your mind. And once you've opened your mind to that, then you start to have ideas. And some of them are good, some of them stink. And over the years, that will prove itself. You know, you have songs that really work for everybody, and you have songs that really don't work for anybody. But you have to be unafraid to fail.
I can think of younger days when living for my life was every bit a man who wants to do. I could never see tomorrow. No one said a word about the sorrow. How can you stop the rain from falling down? How can you stop the sun from shining? What makes the world go round? How can you mend this broken man? How can a loser ever win?
The important part of any song, when you're constructing a song, is the chorus.
Islands in the stream, that is what we are. No one in between, how can we be wrong? Sail away with me to another world, and we rely on each other, From one lover to another,
Especially when you're writing a song that, you know, that you think you want to write a hit record. The magical part of the song is the chorus.
Why do you have to be a heartbreaker? Living a lesson where I'm never
chorus is the part where the song flowers and blossoms. And that's where the song opens up. And if it doesn't happen in the chorus, it doesn't happen anywhere. And that's the magical part. Once you've got that part, everything else takes care of itself.
Taught in everlasting words and dedicate them all. Will give you all my life. I'm here if you should call to me. And you think that I don't even mean a single word I say. It's only words, and words are all I have to take your heart.
I've never really analysed it. I just know that one has to keep sort of changing. I think as songwriters, that's always been something we wanted to do anyway. You can't, as a songwriter, you can't stay in one area all the time. So it's part of, it's nature really for us to want to keep growing and going forward.
You can weave your way in and out of what's going on in the way that we sort of did with Saturday Night Fever. We weren't really what we didn't recognize it as ourselves as being part of any boom that they called disco or any film that was actually disco. We were just we thought we were being innovative by doing music for a film which we hadn't done. And it was something we hadn't done before. And it turned into something else that we had no idea about.
And you come to me on a summer breeze, keep me warm in your love. Then you softly leave, and it's me you need to show. How deep is your love?
VH 1 to 1.
We were in Herriville, in France, recording what we thought was our new album. And Robert Stigwood and Al Curry came to France to meet with us and showed us a script of sorts and asked us if we'd write about four or five songs for this film called Tribal Rites of a New Saturday Night. That's really where it started off. But the five songs, I think More Than a Woman, Staying Alive, How Deep Is Your Love, and Night Fever, I think all were part of that album we were working on and became part of the soundtrack. It was just, I guess, an accident. See, nobody expected anything like what happened with Saturday Night Fever. If you were at the nerve center of that project, you would never have expected you would never have expected the success that came from it. When Fever was very successful, life became a goldfish bowl. It's not a very, very happy way of living. You've got people climbing over your walls. You can't answer your own phone. It's a wonderful sensation to have that kind of success, and it is a different world than normal success but very, very insecure situation for everyone.
No matter how far you go or what you do, you still have to prove yourself in one way or another. If you have success, for some reason, it damages you. And it doesn't happen to many other people, but to us, for some reason, it did. So we got over that obstacle. We just, you know, kept going. And said, if we keep on making the records and keep on writing the songs we love to do, you know, no one can stop us. We just got to keep, if we stop doing it, yes, then we can all say cheerio.
Someday, baby, I should be one. Always, violently, I can see half the sun.
All the heights and all the things, the peaks that we've had, have never been as much fun as they look like they might be. Have never been as much, have brought as much happiness as the times in between when everything was a bit quieter and you had a stable form of life and you got your kids and you got your family. And those things become vital because you have them the whole time. And those things can't be pulled away from you. And those other things can. They're transient, you know. And spiritually, inside is what's far more important than anything else.
There's a lot of things that have brought us together over the years. You know, there's not just the music. There's personal things like losing Andy. So we've fought things together. And it's, once again, it's hard to describe unless you're a brother.
Different times we feel like each other's big brother. It all depends on what the circumstances are and the situation. We all feel differently about each other at different times. We've been working together so much as musicians and writers that over the years you just become, you see each other as fellow musicians and then brothers. I think it's that we can't always work as in a brother relationship. We have to work in a musical relationship, and I think the two have really balanced out well.
Being brothers is vital to that, to the survival of a group like ours, you know. I think that if we hadn't been brothers, I can't imagine that we would have survived as long as this. Because you have a lot of differences in your own personal opinions as well. You have to see something, you have to see the target. You have to, you can't look left and right. You've got to know what you want and go after it all right through your life. And the three of us have been that way. Even though we've differed as people, we've had the same target.
One presents a lesson in vocabulary. Definition: hit. Noun, from the Russian hitovkovich. One, a dosage, as in drug hit. Two, a run-in with the mafia, as in mob hit.
You've been hit by a smooth criminal.
Three, a musical recording of unquestionable popularity, as in hit song. Only one place defines the hits: VH1, the greatest hits of music videos.